Welcome to the award-winning A Celtic State of Mind. I'm Paul John Dykes, and this week's episode comes live from the penalty spot in Glasgow with Simon Donnelly. I've recently done a few Smell the Glove events with Sid to celebrate Wim Jansen's side who stopped the 10, and this week's podcast covers that season, as well as Simon's friendship with Jackie McNamara, the brilliance of Pierre, Paolo and Henrik, his regret at not winning the league for Tommy Burns, and the meteoric rise of Andrew Robertson. So sit back and enjoy Simon Donnelly with A Celtic State of Mind. Andy Robertson, his development really from Queen's Park to Dundee United, a huge part of that was Simon and Jackie, who were at Dundee United at the time. And we've spoken a wee bit about how you identified him, Simon, what type of boy he was, what your aspirations for him were at that time, and how you've watched him kind of develop. So could you think back to when you spotted Robertson and what kind of boy he was when he came to Cannabis?
Well, I can't take any credit for spotting him because it was Jackie. He was brought to Jackie's attention and he went down to Hampden to watch him play for Queen's Park at the time. And I think it took him 45 minutes to realise that, you know, this lad was something that we wanted to go and work with and give him an opportunity at Dundee United. And even your introduction there about how we developed him, but Andy did it himself, you know. We just gave him the platform at Dundee United. Did we think he was going to hit the ground running as much as he did? Possibly not, you know. I think Jackie gave him a contract and said, look, if you get in our first team, we'll rip that up, you know, and we'll renegotiate. And I think Andy did that for himself in terms of how he performed early on in the season. I think the contract was ripped up pretty quickly and we gave him another one, and then the performances that he put in that season got him his move to the Premiership. You know, it got to a point where we as Dundee United could not afford Andy Robertson, and it was down to the kid himself, you know, in terms of what we did and worked with him. He was the best that I worked with as a coach, just in terms of attitude and wanting to, or the will to win, and the desire that he showed. And it was great to play a small part in that, and to sit and watch the Champions League final last night. I just wanted Liverpool to win for the boy, you know. Who's to say he won't be in another one? You know, I think he's going to go from strength to strength. I think he's only 24. But it's full credit to him and his family, just the type of boy he is and what he's achieved in the game, and in terms of how proud everybody was, you know, in terms of his relationship with Celtic here, the Scotsman in the cup final. And as I say, it was just a pity never won.
I mean, he was at Celtic. Did you know what the background to that was? Was it because the squad was so strong, or was he a late developer, Simon?
I don't know. Over the years, you know, I've kept, as a coach and experiencing a coach, being a coach, you can't get everything right. So it's fell through the net there at Celtic. He's obviously been missed. He's went to Queen's Park. I think I heard yesterday that he was working in Marks and Spencer's to make up his money, as he was playing obviously amateur at Queen's Park at the time. But I worked at I did the exit trials, you know, last week for the boys that have just been released for clubs, Thursday, Friday. And I couldn't be at the game on Saturday. I had an engagement on Saturday, so I couldn't be at the game that they play in, you know, and all the coaches come to watch. And hopefully these boys get a second chance. But my kind of leaving word for them was, you know, Andy Robertson, you look at him as he had that setback at Celtic, and he's came back and he's playing in a Champions League final, and take inspiration for that, because people develop at different rates, you know, different paces. You know, if you've been let go for a club, it doesn't necessarily mean your career's finished, and he's the prime example.
Mm-hmm. I mean, one of the interesting tweets that you put out yesterday, and we were talking about it earlier, was Ramos.
Aye.
And his kind of influence in the game. What's your take on that? Because instantly when you see that, you get a lot of people, there's a backlash. But you know, in 30, 40 years, there's going to be no footnote in the history books. It's just that he won it.
It was kind of tongue-in-cheek, obviously, the tweet I put out. But the experience of Ramos, I think he knew what he was doing with Salah there. He obviously didn't mean to pop the guy's shoulder, but he knew he was taking him down. And you know, after 20, 25 minutes when Salah is on Liverpool's main man, you can almost expect Madrid to go in and win it. Mm-hmm. On the back of that, which was disappointing, because I've loved watching Salah this season. one of the best players in the Premiership, one of the best players in the world this year. But Liverpool needed him last night to win that game. And you talk about redefining moments in games, and before a goal's even scored, I thought that was the most crucial moment of the game.
And you know, again, obviously, we look at Robertson having been playing in Scottish football, what was it, 3 or 4 years ago, and Van Dijk as well, playing in Scottish football. Is that an indication that we're a breeding ground? We're a breeding ground for players who can go on to the top level in European football?
It's an indication, I think, that you look at Van Dijk having to go to Southampton after Celtic to get the move to Liverpool, and the money they spent. Now, if Liverpool had identified Van Dijk from Celtic, they wouldn't have had to pay the huge fee that they paid because he was performing in the Premiership. I think Scottish football's overlooked. I think we've got a lot of good players up here, and you're almost dismissed. You know, even Celtic's achievements over the last couple of years, aren't people poo-poo that down south. It's an arrogance, I think, you know, because I think we've got a lot of good players here, and just have they two, you know, coming through. Obviously, Andy went from Queen's Park to Dundee United, and Van Dijk came through from Holland to Celtic. It shows that we have guys here that can handle the top level, and those two are the perfect example.
Now, we're here to speak partly about the Celtic Greats games against Rangers. You were involved in the real thing a number of times. I think your dad reminds you all the time that you never scored against Rangers.
Does,
what was your memories of those big games against Rangers back in the 90s?
Well, I spoke about this the other day with this ticket allocation nonsense. A couple of people contacted me. I don't know if you remember the game in 94, but there was no Celtic fans. I don't know what happened the year before, but they were banned, and that was my first Rangers game, my first Old Firm game, and I played up front myself against Richard Goff. Thought I did alright. We should have won the game. John Collins scored a fantastic free kick, and Mikhailichenko got a deflected equaliser late on in the game. But in terms of those games, I think I've always said, you know, European nights and the Rangers games are the ones I loved playing in, and that one I look back fondly because it was my first. But I quite liked the idea of getting into Ibrox, you know, the Lions then, and there was no support there. We were representing the club, and it was only the players and the staff. And I think it brought something out in us, you know, to go in there and try and, I think there was a plane across Ibrox, you know, to indicate that we knew we had the support there, but just because we were in there in the Lions then, and I experienced it recently, actually, with Dundee United going back there for a neutral semi-final, but it just brings that wee bit more edge to it. As I say, unfortunately, we didn't get the one that day.
And how do you, I mean, that's gone back a few years, but how's that going to affect, will it affect a Celtic team going to Ibrox next season?
I don't think it'll affect in terms of the game, because I think once you go into a game, the players just switch on. Don't get me wrong, I think when you're at Ibrox and you've got the sea of green and white behind the goal to celebrate goals and games, it's fantastic. But I don't think it will affect the players in terms of the results. I think the quality will still be there, the focus will still be there with Celtic. I just feel for the fans for that one, because you're talking about 800 people going to the game now, so the scramble for tickets, people are going to miss out on that experience. And I still say the same for Rangers fans coming to Celtic Park. You know, it adds to the spectacle. But I don't think it will, when you get down to 9 minutes, I don't think it will affect the game.
Now, we've just spoken to Rudy Vata, who was quite honest in saying that Tommy Burns didn't fancy him as a player, but by the end of that 94-95 season, he was in and about it, and he was a part of the cup winning side. What's your memories of that season? Because we've discussed this before. You'd had a great end, really. I think it was 5 goals in 10 games at the tail end of the previous year, and then going into this season, you were the bright new hope.
Aye. Well, the season after I broke in, as you say, I scored 5 goals in 10 games, and at 19 years of age, I thought, this is easy. And I had a horrendous season the next year. We were at Hampden, I had injuries, I never scored. Peter Grant reminded me at the time, he scored 1 goal, and he says, this is the first season that I've actually scored more goals than a striker at Celtic, referring to me, which didn't make me feel great. But we, as I say, we got the cup final, and Rudy said earlier on, I was actually just listening to it when Rudy said, an important period, because we hadn't won a trophy for so long, and Tommy Burns was back at the club, and it was the first step on, you know, Celtic survival. And me at 19 or 20 or whatever age I was, kind of just took it in my stride. But I looked at the likes of Paul McStays and Peter Grant, who'd experienced the success at Celtic years before and had to endure that period of time where there was no success, just to see the reaction in these guys, and Tommy and Billy Stark who achieved the 88 centenary double. It meant the world to these guys, and it was such an important couple in that one. Anyway, Paul McStay, I think Paul McStay said to me after that game, take it on, take it on. And at 19, you listen to him, but you're still thinking, ach, we'll have more Scottish Cup wins here. This is par for the course. It wasn't, and it was my only Scottish Cup win, 1995. So it's funny how things pan out like that. But you do, you have to savour it. You have to savour it.
One of the interesting things, again, for those who were going week in, week out, it was a high point, I think, when Van Hooydonk signed in November. And it was one of the ones, Jamie, you're going to the game, you don't know who the guy is, you can't check your phone and say, right, who's Pierre Van Hooydonk?
With a dodgy moustache. Thankfully getting rid of that.
I can't remember the moustache. I need to check that
moustache.
And you know, you're going to the game, you don't know who he is, what he looks like, nothing. And he obviously scored that night, and it was 1-1. You spoke earlier, previously with me, about the Cantona effect with Van Hooydonk. Yeah. What did he bring to the squad?
Pierre just brought, as I say, I was the same as you, I never knew him for Adam. And I remember his debut, I was injured. Again, that infamous season. And I was sitting in the main stand at Hampden, and he scored, was it against Hearts? And you could just tell right away, you know, that this was somebody who, I think Tommy Burns and I think Davey Hay was involved in it as well, would spotted him in Holland and identified him as somebody that could come and make a statement at Celtic. And I think just for us as players at the time, bringing that quality to the club, it raised everything. You know, good players feed off good players, and I was coming through as a youngster, and just to watch Pierre after training, he'd do that free kick. You know, he's an expert at free kick. I think he's up there with David Beckham in terms of the way he could bend a ball, but it was all the work after, you know, the 90 minute session we did. He would stay back with 100 balls, and it just brought it more to young guys' attention, like myself. This is what's needed, you know, to improve your game. He's one of the best I've played with, Pierre. Henrik's up there, but Pierre, I mean, if you look at Pierre's career and his goals to game ratio, wherever he's been, he's played in a semi-final of the World Cup. He's a top player.
You mentioned Henrik, so we'll jump a few years ahead. We had a good discussion. I never thought Simon would tell me what happened between Posh and Henrik on the training ground. But it was quite interesting because you seen that as one of many kind of pivotal moments of that season, didn't you, in 1997-98?
Oh, no, sorry.
Listen, I mean, I'm good mates with Posh, and I know he doesn't like looking back in that. It was just something that happened in training, but at the time, the intensity and the will to win in training games, I think that's why Vim had... It set up the squad, you know, the guys who have got the jersey against the guys that didn't have the jersey, and it brought that intensity to training, and it kind of spilled over. And it's not the first time, and it certainly will never be the last, but whatever it did that day, it kind of broke down the barriers between possibly the formers at the time and just an acceptance. I mean, we touched on it earlier on about the five guys we did the thing at the walkabout with. That dressing room, it was probably the closest dressing room that I've been in terms of in friendship. We used to go out together, sociable. All the wives and girlfriends got on, and I think it needed that, you know, to slot the 10 that year. I think that dressing room was really tight. But as I say, it's one of these things that's, well, I think it was before an Old Firm game as well. There was fans at Barrowfield watching us, and inevitably it made the headlines the next morning.
I think Tosh McKinley's dad had been at training or something like that. Tommy Johnson was saying that, and somebody says to Tosh's dad that he had headbutted Larson, eh?
Aye.
But I mean, that particular kind of era, you know, you've played with Rudy. Rudy Vatter just told us one of the most incredible stories I've ever heard for a footballer, yeah, about his journey from Albania to Celtic. When you played alongside him, were you aware of that kind of background, or is that just kind of come to fruition now?
I know the story, but again, really interesting just listening back to what he's went through in his life, and an absolute character. I had a spell there where I just kind of signed with Celtic. I think I signed the month before him, and I remember him. I remember the first team boys joking about me at the time, because he used to come in and cut his own hair in front of the mirror in the dressing room.
That's what I did.
And the boys used to give him stick, but just to listen to what he's came through there and what, you know, from where he's been to where he.
So he would actually cut his own hair and changing it.
And you can imagine a dressing room with Peter Grant's and Charlie Nicholas's. They wouldn't leave, you know what I mean? They wouldn't miss that. But thankfully, it looks as if he's not cutting his own hair now. No, he was a character, Rudy, and I've always had a lot of time for him. And the experiences, you should do the book with him, because that's a fantastic story.
It is a great story. And as well as the names you've mentioned, you also played with the Three Amigos. And Andreas Tom.
Yeah.
So what's your memories of Cadetti and particularly De Canio?
De Canio was crazy. I remember him, I think we were in Holland or Germany pre-season. He needed a ball for himself, you know, the guy could turn people inside out with just his ability. Larger than life character. Possibly not Celtic long enough, you know, things happened there, but he certainly made his mark with his ability. Cadetti, I was aware of because we'd played sport in Lisbon a couple of years before. I don't think I was quite in the first team at the time, but I think George scored against us. So to get him to the club in 96 or whatever it was, and his first goal against Aberdeen that night at Celtic Park, amazing. And I met up with him recently. He was back over. I was doing a wee bit with Celtic TV, and I was speaking to him, and somebody had asked me about him. And I'd looked at the goals over the years. George was one of these guys who, it was just a goal machine, and whatever run he would make, it would actually make your job as a midfielder easy, because he would make runs and he would just slide drill balls and ultimately he would finish it off. He was just such a good one to work with, not in terms of maybe a link up, but the runs he made, you know, he put it in and he would score. Andy Tom, another fantastic player who I didn't know anything about before he came to Celtic, another great guy as well, explosive right foot. He scored a fantastic finish at Ibrox, it was a 3-3 game. But all these guys were coming through at a time where, as I say, Tommy Burns was bringing these guys in, and it was elevating your game as well, because you were playing with top international players. And it was a great period, that 96 team that we, I think we only get beat once in the season, was an absolute joy to play, and some of the football was brilliant. And just one of my kind of regrets was no winning the league that year, because Tommy, for the style of football, the Celtic way they call it, that was what he was trying to bring to the team. And I thought we gave that to the fans that year. We just drew too many games.
Did we not say it was about 18 games drawn that season? Yeah, that's why we didn't win.
That's what killed it for
I mean, the other thing again is the kind of friendship and the playing relationship between yourself and Jackie. Jackie comes in, and I think you took him under your wing, and you're friends to this day. I mean, what was he like when he came in? He's coming from Dunfermline, it's a big step up. How were you able to help him when he came to Celtic Park?
Just because I was the kind of same age group. I know you mentioned that to him at the walkabout, with me taking him under his wing, because ultimately he became my boss at Dundee United and stuff. But no, we're best mates, and it was just, we played in under 21s together, so I knew him from that. And then when he signed, I thought, great signing for us. Didn't realise that the kind of relationship we're going to have on the right side. Thankfully Tommy had pulled me away from being the kind of the striker role and playing me in a deeper role. But just because we're the same age group, and he was coming to Celtic, and I'd obviously experienced this season or whatever, season and a half playing the first team, and just made him feel welcome, you know, because it was a big move for him. I'd come through to Celtic. I was fortunate enough to come through for 17, but to come for Dunfermline, it was a huge step up for him. And it just kept, it clicked, you know, on and off the pitch, it just clicked. And that 96 season was, as I said, an absolute joy to play with. But playing with him on the right side, we kind of knew where each other was wanting the ball, runs. It was just a good period.
Now, the thing with Jackie as well, and I know I spoke to him in Glasgow on that night that you referred to, and he's doing other things, so he's quite happy at the minute. But surely he's a big loss to the management game in Scotland when you look at the Dundee United players in a very short space of time that you identified, nurtured, developed, sold on. So you had Robertson, Gold, Armstrong, Chiefchi, Kai Stephen. I mean, how big a loss is he to Scottish football as a manager?
I think he's a huge loss. I think even after the work we did at Partick Thistle as well, but football's a funny game, as somebody once said, you know, perception stuff. It's almost as if we never achieved anything at Partick Thistle or Dundee United. But I think if you ask any of the boys that we worked with, you know, they certainly enjoyed working under us, and Jackie's role as manager was pivotal. You know, it's as I say, it's a funny one. Football's volatile. You can be the best thing since sliced bread and five bad results and you're out the door. And I think that experience kind of left a bad taste in his mouth, and I think that's why at this current period he's not too fussed about taking another role, you know, at managerial levels. But you rhymed off five or six players there that we lost. I was talking to somebody yesterday, I thought if we'd been able to keep those five or six players for another year, we could really have achieved something at Dundee United. But unfortunately, Robertson became too big for us. Armstrong, Mackay, Stephen went to Celtic, Sifji, Ford, Gold goes to Sport Lisbon. Mm-hmm. You know, as a young boy, a great opportunity for him. How can you deprive him of that? So it's just football.
Will Gold come back, do you think? Will he still have that?
I would love to see. Gold's a Celtic type player. I mean, he was fantastic. He was in our first team at 16. I felt if he'd played another year there, scored some goals and kicked on. But again, you can't knock the boy. Rudy spoke about it earlier on. He's took an opportunity or a gamble to go and play abroad. I knew he always wanted to play abroad. It's not quite worked out for him yet, but he's a talent. And I would not be surprised, you know, if he bounces back.
Hopefully he does. We did a gig fairly recently in Castle Douglas, which I thought was half an hour down the road. I quickly found it wasn't.
So did I.
And it was interesting because we did a Q&A at the end, and some of the most interesting questions came for that, which I don't know what that says about me as an interviewer, but one of the most interesting questions that was asked that night, somebody said it tongue in cheek about Chichi being a waste of money.
Yeah.
And you put him right and you told him this guy was a talent.
Yeah.
You're surprised it's not worked out for him, etc.
Yeah.
When he moved to Celtic, what did you think Nadir would achieve?
I thought he'd go on to be a player for Celtic. I told him to take the seven. I thought he had the shoulders to go and take the number seven at Celtic, which obviously is a huge number, and be himself. And as I said to you at the time, a boy who scored 19 goals for us at Dundee United and performed so well to get into that Celtic team, I thought he would have been a star. And for whatever reason, it didn't work out for him. I still think he is a talent. You know, he's only 24, 25, but his time at Celtic just didn't work out. And sometimes when moves like that happen, you know, it either clicks or it doesn't click for you. But I thought coming through your team at that time where he was flying, I thought he did really well for Celtic.
Mm-hmm. Smell of love, I could see that there was a really good kind of bond between the players when we spoke in Glasgow.
Yeah.
What was the setup in terms of team bonding? Was Tommy Johnson, was he the kind of convener of that?
It was, I think we spoke about it on the evening. I think Tommy was he plays it down the role he had there, because he never played a lot of football that year. He obviously went on to score. I think he scored the all-important goal against St Mirren to win the league a few years later. But what we did have there was a camaraderie and a togetherness, and he was at the centre of it all the time. Tommy Boyd, that you touched on there, was always the more organised guy. We'll go and play golf, we'll do this, we'll do that. But Tommy Johnson loved a night out, and that really brought that group of players together. You know, and we're fortunate because that season you can maybe look at guys who made a huge contribution on the pitch, but there was guys there that maybe only played a few games, but whenever they were asked to do it, they did a job, and that's why that group is so close. That's why we kind of keep in touch. He had a huge role to play.
And Larson was just one of the boys you were saying that night. Was he just one of the boys?
Henrik
Larson. Yeah.
Henrik was, when he came out, I obviously knew Henrik for the 94 World Cup. You know, I think they got the third and fourth, and obviously the dreadlocks. And he came, and we took him out for a couple of nights out, and it was like the same as all the European guys. They kind of, what's this all about? But they slowly but surely grew to kind of learn this is what we do, and it's a camaraderie. And Henrik was first class. He's still, when I see him to these days, you know, after everything he's achieved in the game, he's just a normal guy. Humility, fantastic.
Now, Celtic greats. We're talking to Rudy before. Obviously, you and Rudy played together.
Yeah.
And you're playing alongside the likes of Mark Burchell. Who else is involved in these games?
We've got obviously the Rangers ones as well. I know these guys don't want to refer to them as greats, but they've played for Rangers on the other side of the fence. Listen, these games are brilliant, you know, in terms of you're a long time retired in football. Jackie retired me at 35 at Partick, and he likes to remind everybody about it. But these games give you the opportunity to see these guys that you've not played with for so many years. The experience of the game again, the fans come out to see it, just giving a wee bit back. It's they're really good occasions. I think we've played five. I think we've won four. So, you know, there's that competitive edge still, even now at 43. But they're great ones to play in, and it's good occasions. You know, you get down to these, I've played at some junior pitches that I never even knew existed recently. And I think the next one's at Irvine Meadow. So, no, I'm looking forward to it.
And there's always a few celebs in the starting lineups as well.
Methadone Mick this time.
Methadone Mick. Will be appearing for Celtic. I don't know if he's going to have the teeth in.
Listen, I've got three boys, and that's the most excited I've seen them when Methadone Mick was announced. I was at the Henrik Lubo game last year, and you had Henrik, you had Lubo, you had all the Celtic legends. My boys were more excited seeing Methadone Mick, so there you go.
Now, Simon, we've got the Simon Donnelly Supporters Club here. So I'm wondering if you've got any questions that you'd like to post to Simon.
Since you spoke about the 95-96 team, it was a privilege to watch that team. It was a great season, but I still feel cheated by it all, and I don't know how you as a player feels. To me, it was from day one. You played European games on a Thursday evening, then you had to play on a Saturday, because I remember we lost 2-0 to Rangers at a lunchtime Saturday kickoff, and all. I think we dropped a number of points after these European games. Then there was the George Cadet affair, which, whenever it gets mentioned, people say, oh, he missed the cup semi-final. To me, he missed a lot of league games that cost us. I'm just wondering if you feel any anger about how the team was treated.
I don't feel any anger. I'm just you're reminding me there, actually, about the European games. I think we played in places like Batumi, and having to come back, you know, flying through the night and having to play, I think it was Motherwell or somebody on the Saturday. It was difficult. It was difficult. I don't feel any anger. I just, there's regret there for me, because that season I thought we played some of the best football that I've been involved in. And I've got as many people like yourself that talk about that season as much as the 98 season, which was hugely important to the club. Just regret, because I think Tommy Burns, what he was trying to achieve at the time, and the style of football that he put on show, you know, by bringing players in to complement the guys that were already there, it's just a regret that we drew too many games. And you could probably look back at a number of things that season, you know, the European games or whatever, as you know, the a result of that. But I still look back at it with great pride and, you know, enjoyment to play in that team with those players, and put football on the way I think football should be played. You know, entertaining, goals, attractive, creative stuff for players, for fans to come and get excited about. That's the style of football I like to play. And it's just, you know, unlucky that we didn't win the title.
It culminated in that 5-0 game against Aberdeen. That was just one of the best games I've ever been to.
I enjoyed that game. It was a good night.
Any other questions for Simon? I'd just like to thank Simon Donnelly for coming here today. It's always an absolute pleasure and privilege. Big round of applause for Simon.
Celtic State of Mind's previous episodes can be accessed by searching iTunes, Spreaker, or your pre-installed podcast player. Make sure to subscribe and you won't miss our upcoming episodes with former players, musical icons, documentary makers and Celtic supporters. You can keep up to date with us and get in touch at Paul Dykes, at A Northern Prose and at Celtic Star Pod. We also have a new website, www.theceltic-star.com, and on that website we have a host of writers giving you daily Celtic news, including Jim Craig, who gives a morning blog. We also have contributors such as myself, Kevin Graham, David Potter and Scotty Allcroft. Tune in next week. We will have another guest with a Celtic state of mind.